Drink, they told me. I looked down at the cup in my left hand. The liquid within was hot. Froth had collected around the rim. I felt a sudden thirst break out. I lifted the cup halfway to my mouth, and my hand trembled as I did so. I knew something important was in there, but I held back. My instincts warred within me. Drink, they told me. The tone of their command gave me pause. I did not know why they wanted me to do it. It was then that I saw him. He came from the opposite direction. He had the shape of a man too, but the halo of light around him made it hard to make much more out than that. I could not see his face. He was coming toward me, and I knew, without knowing how, that he had traveled from a long, long way away. He gave me no command. Other than that, he was like the four beast figures. There was some relationship between them, something I could sense but not understand. The four were scared of him. I knew then that if I drank from the cup, then I would be defying him. If I did not drink, I would be defying them. We all remained like that for the space of many thoughts. The four pointed at me. The man wreathed in light walked toward me, never seeming to come any closer. Drink, they told me. I lifted the cup to my lips. I took a sip. The liquid had a complex taste, sweet to begin with, then bitter. I felt it flow down my throat, hot and vital. As soon as I had started, I felt an urge to keep drinking. I wanted nothing more than to swallow it all down, to drain it to the dregs. Drink, they told me. After that one sip, I put the cup down, crouching carefully and resting it on the earth before me. For all my care, it spilled a little, staining my fingers. Then I took a step away from it. I bowed to the four, not wishing to give offense. I spoke, not knowing where my words came from. It is courteous to take a small amount, I said. That is enough for us. The four lowered their arms. They did not command me again. The man stopped walking, still just where he had been when I had first seen him. I felt that I had disappointed all of them. Perhaps, though, I had disappointed him less than I had them. The Legiones Astartes would incur many losses during the years of the Horus Heresy. Blood would be spilt across 100 war zones as denizens of unknown realms would spill forth from the Immaterium and threaten the survival of humanity itself. For the loyalist Astartes of the Imperium, all would suffer the loss of kin, with some even torn from the guiding hand of their Primarchs. Yet among all the fallen heroes of the Great Civil War, one would give his life not solely for his legion, nor his Primarch, but the fate of humanity. The Chief Stormseer of the White Scars Legion, Targutai Yesugei. Upon the world of Chogoris, war would wage across its vast plains between two opposing forces. The technologies of the planet, comparable to ancient Terra's late medieval period, the feudal aristocracy, known as the Palatine, of the world designated as Mundus Planus, would lord over the tribesmen of the grasslands. Enforcing their will with their armies of pre-industrial soldiers, the nomadic horsemen of the plains would stand in stark contrast to their plate-mailed oppressors. To the west of the Palatine's empire, the so-called Empty Quarter would comprise the territories of the tribes protected by the winter valleys of the Kumkata Mountains. Yet the prosperity of the tribes of Chogoris would burgeon following the discovery of the Master of Mankind's son. Found near the Kuoan River by the leader of the Tauskar's tribe, Ong Khan, the orphan son of the Emperor would be raised to follow in his new guardian's example. Naming the boy Jaghatai, Ong Khan would observe the fire within the boy's eyes and foresee his potential as a great warrior. As he grew, the young Primarch would be hated by the rival tribes of the Empty Quarter. Though growing to become a warrior without peer,
Jaghatai would imagine beyond his people's constant warring and resolve to unite the people of Chogoris. The Kurayed tribe would slay Jaghatai's adoptive father and incur his wrath for their transgression. Razing the Kurayed tribe's yurts to the ground and killing every man, woman, and child, the Primarch would achieve vengeance by annihilating his aggressors. Swearing to his people that he shall once and for all put an end to fighting between the tribes of the Empty Quarter, Jaghatai would begin his conquest to unite his people. Succeeding in his quest after hundreds of battles, the Chogoran tribes would unite under the banner of their new Khan. Followers would flock to his army as the Warhawk of Chogoris sought to overthrow the tyrants of the Palatine to finally unify his homeworld. Achieving victory over the Palatine, Jaghatai would be attributed the title of Khagan by the elders of the tribes of the Empty Quarter. The Khan of Khans now began his conquest of the rest of his homeworld and formed bonds of brotherhood with several comrades in arms who would go on to become his close advisors. With one such advisor rising above all to become the Khagan's closest friend, Targutai Yesugei. A gifted psyker, once known as Shinaz, with his induction into the Ordu of Jaghatai, a new name would be befitting such wise counsel. Alongside his future battle brothers, Chinsha and Hasik, Targutai would utilize his restrained yet potent manipulations of the warp to aid in the Khagan's conquests. Offering the people of each city of Chogoris to surrender or die, most would willingly submit to the new rule of the Khan of Khans. Crossing oceans and expanding their empire across their world, Chogoris would witness the ascension of its new ruler. Ending the wars that scarred its plains, Jaghatai would nonetheless observe the absence of political structures and organizations required to maintain his newly united peoples. Yet with the arrival of the Master of Mankind to Mundus Planus, foreseeable instability would not be forthcoming. 6 months following the unification of Chogoris, the Emperor would descend upon the Empty Quarter and meet with his long-lost son during 865.M30. Met by his gene father and the Primarch of the Lunar Wolves Legion, Horus Lupercal, Jaghatai would observe the ceramite-clad warriors at their command. Realizing his people stood no chance in combating such foes, and reasoning his own ambitions to align with his father, the Khagan would pledge his loyalty to the Imperium. Relieved of the mundane responsibilities of rulership, the Khagan and his men would be offered a purpose befitting their free-spirited independence. Installed as the leader of the 5th Legion, the Star Hunters, Jaghatai would see to his Chogoran warriors' transformations as members of the Legiones Astartes. Yesugei among them, these new warriors would adopt the gleaming white armor first seen adorning the Lunar Wolves of the 16th Legion, and outfit their new panoplies with markings and honorifics befitting their culture. Unleashed across the stars to bring worlds into the compliance of the Imperium, the 5th Legion would with time muster its scattered pathfinders to return to Chogoris with their blooding complete. Ritually scarring their faces and adopting their new names to honor the traditions of Chogoris, the 5th Legion would be reborn as the White Scars. Mistrusted by many within the Legiones Astartes, the nomadic tribesmen of the 5th Legion would challenge the prescribed doctrines and beliefs of the Imperial Truth. Though adherent to the Emperor's vision of a united galaxy, the methods used and trappings of the White Scars would call their intent into question. Primarch Rabute Gilliban of the Ultramarines and Rogal Dawn of the Imperial Fists would decry the swift induction of the Khagan into the fold of the Great Crusade. Believing Jaghatai to willfully misinterpret the tenets of the Imperial Truth and its foundational cultural advisements, the White Scars' strange methods of harnessing the warp would further encourage the misgivings of their peers. Regarding their librarians as Stormseers, these shamanistic interpreters of the will of the Immaterium would cause their more austere contemporaries to bristle. Venerating their council above many of the Astartes within the 5th Legion, Jaghatai would see wisdom in their use of their powers and respect their adherence to resist the temptations inherent when harnessing the warp. Believing their powers to be drawn from the animalistic spirits of the natural world, many within the Imperium would profess their disdain for their spiritualistic superstition. Crafting staffs made of wood, hewn from the trees native to the soil of the Kumkata Mountains, the Stormseers would carve protective sigils into the bark of their totems and purport to imbue their own psychic imprint. Said to preserve a memory of the bearer's own personality and deeds, fellow librarians would scoff at such pagan ideals. Yet with Targutai Yesugei's appointment as the chief librarian of the White Scars, even the most prolific scholars of the warp would concede their ignorance of their understanding of the Stormseer's proven skill at harnessing its power. Targutai would form strong bonds of camaraderie and mutual respect among the librarians of the legions, such as Chief Librarian of the Thousand Suns, Arzek Araman. His Primarch and exponent of the utility of the Librarius, despite the 15th Legion's call for censure, the White Scars would stand at the side of their allies during the Council of Nikea. Drafting the outlining principles of the Librarius, alongside the Primarch of the Thousand Suns, Magnus the Red, and Primarch of the Blood Angels, Sanguinius, Jaghatai would uphold his own Stormseers as exponents of the responsible use of the warp for the benefit of the Imperium. Though unable to attend the pivotal debate at the Council of Nikea, Jaghatai Khan would send his most trusted advisor, Targutai, to represent him in his stead. Divulging his knowledge and experience to the assembled proponents and detractors of the Council, Targutai would speak in the presence of the Emperor himself and outline his belief that the use of psychers within the Legiones Astartes would be crucial to their effectiveness. Warning of the dangers posed by the use of the warp, Targutai would nonetheless champion its responsible use by the sons of the Primarchs. Despite such a wise counsel, the fears of the many of the meddling of the Thousand Suns within the Great Ocean would prove to be too great to ignore. The Master of Mankind would decree that all use of psychers within the Legiones Astartes and Imperial Army would henceforth be banned, and all who currently served as librarians within the legions must abandon further use of the powers of the warp. Returning to Chogoris to await further instruction from his Khagan, Targutai would adhere to the demands of the Emperor and see to the continued recruitment and resupply of the 5th Legion. Yet Yesugei would feel a great sense of unease as the sundering of the Imperium began to unfold in the dark corners of the galaxy. Warmaster Horus Lupercal would begin his betrayal of the Imperium and incur the wrath of the Emperor. As the Great Khan fought within the Chondax campaign, the loyalist legions of the Iron Hands, Salamanders, and Raven Guard would be tasked with crushing the traitor rebellion within the Istvan system. Unwilling to ignore his instincts, fed by the unknown origin of his sense of impending dread, Yesugei would traverse the warp with a contingent of the White Scars to meet with his Primarch. Exiting their venture of the Immaterium, Yesugei's forces would be confronted by a Sons of Horus void ship harboring survivors from the Istvan V dropsite massacre. Informed of the betrayal of the Warmaster and the coalition of the traitor legions by the Salamander's captain, Zarvan, Yesugei would allow the shattered legion survivors to join his forces in their journey to meet with the Khagan. Intercepted by the Wordbearer's legion during their voyage, despite fending off their assaults, Yesugei's sparse moments of rest would be tormented with dreams of the death of his Primarch. Reaching their destination of the Thousand Suns' homeworld, Prospero, Yesugei would observe Death Guard vessels in open combat with the White Scars fleet. With the 14th Legion's flagship, Endurance, posing the greatest threat to the White Scars fleet, Yesugei and his band of captured traitor warships helmed by the Shattered Legions would intervene to aid the Warhawk. The White Scars of Jaghatai's fleet had erupted into conflicting loyalties, as conspirators under the command of Hasik Noyan Khan would fight their brethren in the name of the Warmaster. Jaghatai Khan would traverse from the surface of Prospero to find his legion in disarray and quell the strife among his men. Reorganized and united in purpose, the White Scars fleet of Jaghatai would relieve Yesugei's ragtag fleet from the Endurance's guns. Repelling the Death Guard fleet and fleeing from the battle, Targutai would with great relief reunite with his Genesire. Their circumstance far from ideal, the Warhawk of Chogoris would beseech his closest friend for guidance during his legion's most perilous hour. Judging the conspirators of Hasiknoyan Khan, the Primarch of the White Scars would offer his wayward sons a chance at redemption. Under the advisement of his close friend, any who would rescind their naive allegiance to the Warmaster would be marked as Sagyar Mazan, and as penance, oppose the Lupercal's forces alone to atone for their betrayal. Those who would refuse would be slain by the Primarch's own hand. Few among the judged would remain loyal to the Warmaster, yet the blood of numerous of Jaghatai's sons would nonetheless stain his sword. The White Scars Legion would, while near to full strength, be cut off from the Imperium. Surrounded on all sides by traitor legions, the White Scars would spend 4 years conducting hit-and-run raids against the Warmaster's forces, yet incur heavy casualties for their actions. Yesugei would form a strong bond of friendship with the last son of Prospero, Revuel Arvida, and aid his warp-cursed brother-in-arms in staving off his legion's affliction, the Flesh Change. Discovering the mysterious Dark Glass Station, the White Scars would stumble upon the ancient Dark Age of Technology artifact. Considered to be the prototype for the Golden Throne, to which the Emperor would cast the light of the Astronomicon to guide his armies to return to Terra, a slim hope would allow for the 5th Legion to return to the Throne World. Besieged during the Battle of Catalus by the forces of the Emperor's Children and Death Guard Legions, many heroes of the White Scars would fall as Yesugei attempted to unlock the mysteries of the Dark Glass. Revuel Arvida would struggle to control the Flesh Change, as the first captain and leader of the Keshig, Chin Sha, would perish in their battle against overwhelming odds. Realizing only a being as powerful as the Master of Mankind would survive interfacing with the machine, Yesugei would nonetheless find a means to save his kin. Vortex charges tore through the foundations of the station, and without reprieve, the war-wearied White Scars and their Primarch would inevitably fall this day. As the station collapsed around him, Targutai Yesugei would attach himself to the control throne of the Dark Glass, and as his last act, create a portal through the webway to allow for the escape of his legion. The Sagyar Mazan would lay a trap within the White Scars' flagship, Stormsword, and as a last act of absolution, confront the Primarch of the Death Guard, Mortarion, to buy time for their legion's traversal through the portal. As Yesugei's body disintegrated from the immense channeled powers of the Dark Glass, he would project a final farewell to his closest companions. As Ilya Revelion and Revuel Arvida would be imparted with pleas to protect his legion, Targutai Yesugei would be disintegrated from existence as the last White Scars void ship passed through the portal. His sacrifice, ensuring the survival of his kin and their fulfillment of their oath to defend humanity.
"In the beginning, I was Shinaz," Yesugei said, managing to convey some kind of broken humor amid the pain. "Remember that? You named me."
"Do not do it," the Khan murmured, his mind racing, guessing at last what had happened. The machinery, the underpalace, the absence of his father from the war. With sudden, terrible clarity, the pieces fell into order. "This is my command. Do not do it."
"The deep ways are perilous, and Yaksha will thrive in it. You are their protector."
The Khan was moving then, striding down the command throne. The teleporters might be usable, even now.
"Targutai, this will end you. Do not do it. Return to the ship."
"Know that I would have followed you to the end, my lord. I would have stood beside you on Terra. When I am gone, do not let them forget. Do not let them become what is fateful. Come back. You are their protector."
Then he was gone, wrenched out of existence. Jaghatai staggered, slipped to one knee. The world seemed to sway, knocked from its axis. He looked up, and the entire bridge was tilting, falling. Ilya was screaming. The Prosperine sorcerer was crying aloud. The warriors of the Sagyar Mazan were looking out to the void, ushering in the final battle. His legion was dying.
"I still need you,"
The Khan cast his head back, his imperious reserve broken open. He clenched his fists to the heavens and howled out his rage and his grief. And for a sparse moment, there were no more sounds, no more thoughts. Only the black thunder of a Primarch's mortal fury. This has been a tale of the Great Imperium of Man, read by the Remembrancer. Targutai Yesugei would endure as a symbol of the Fifth Legion's sacrifice made in the name of humanity. There are few heroes within the vast archives of Imperial history whose sacrifice eclipses the Stormseer of Chogoris. Hold close those you cherish, for none among us shall outlast the stars that glitter in the void. For Yesugei's legacy is not of sacrifice, but love for his kin. And there are few virtues more noble than the unreserved duty to protect your brethren.